We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is June 1st, 2016. And I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com, NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, SoundCloud, Tumblr, and the next day on Stitcher. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And of course, I left out self-ownership, which is one of the most important things. And if you'd like to call in, we'd be happy to hear from you. You can bring up whatever you want or comment on what we are talking about. You can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or call in via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and just send a contact request with your name and what you want to talk about. And check us out on NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which links to our Facebook page and other social media info, as well as our articles, including our new article/blog series on the war on drugs, and our donation page. So if you'd like to donate, you can donate at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. So tonight, we kind of have a open sort of show. There are a few things that I plan on talking about, but unfortunately, I wasn't as able to prepare as much as I would have liked. It's been a rough day today. I didn't get enough sleep last night as I was up working on articles, as I'm really trying to get this done. And I started talking about it yesterday, the series that I'm working on the drug war, and how drugs should be legal like they were before the 1920s, before 1914 specifically. That was the first law against heroin. So what I'm doing, and I talked about this yesterday as well, is trying to cover all aspects of the drug war from the side of why it should be legalized and why there shouldn't even be a drug war. You know, everything in this country is a war. The war on terrorism, the war on this, the war on that. They just love war. The Defense Department even used to be called the War Department, but they thought, you know, that sounded kind of bad, which, of course, it does. So they changed it from the Defense Department to the War Department. So a couple things we're going to talk about tonight, and then we'll just see where things, I guess, kind of take us. Hopefully we'll get some calls. We haven't had any in a while, but if not, I still have things to talk about. I want to talk about the Libertarian Party. Their nomination was this past weekend, which was Gary Johnson, again, of New Mexico, the former governor. So we want to talk about that. That I had mentioned, you'll never see that, or haven't seen it since, I believe, Nixon was the last Republican or Democrat to lose and then be the nominee again. Now, the Libertarian Party is a lot different, but we'll tell you why Gary Johnson should not be the nominee and how the Libertarian Party, from the information I'm getting, which is inside information, you know, just listening to Free Talk Live and really Daryl Perry, who ran for the nomination and was on the show as well, the things that he's said about the process and the Libertarian Party and the nominees as well. So we'll talk a little about that. We're going to talk about threesomes. Don't ask me how that came up because I have no idea. But I kind of just was thinking about ideas for today's show, as, again, I didn't have a lot of time to think today. It was I was really busy with work. Between that and being really tired after work, I took a nap. And so that's something that I wanted to talk about, and how it's anti-feminist in a sense, where that is definitely something that feminists are against. And I'm talking about threesomes, two girls and a guy. Of course, I'm sure that feminists are fine with three girls together or something, as long as the guys aren't watching, or, you know, three guys or something like that. Or I think that would be it, because I don't think they'd be okay with two guys and a girl. I guess unless the guys were, I don't know. So we're going to talk about threesomes. And we're also going to talk about this video that I came across of a black woman talking about white privilege and racism. And along with that, there's two videos that I think are actually related, and I believe done by the same person. And it really brings up the question of, can you sit there and criticize racism and then be racist as well? And really, what is a definition of racism? Of course, that's something that I'm against, but you get, just like on, for example, I've talked about Serious Progressive, and they would not say anything bad ever about Muslims, but they talk about Catholics all the time. And, you know, I have no allegiance in any of this when it comes to race, when it comes to religion, any of it. I don't believe in organized religion, although on my father's side, his side of the family was Jewish. And my mother is Catholic, but I don't believe in any of that. And I don't feel any affiliation or closeness to any culture, whether it be I don't know that there's a white culture. I guess that would be more of a specific country's culture, like, you know, the German culture or the, which is, it doesn't sound like at least in the more recent years, a good, a lot of positive things about the German culture or the Italian culture or the Portuguese culture or something, English culture, whatever, Irish culture. And I think that, too, is where the racism kind of comes in as well, where, and I don't even think people do this, some people do it, where people are coming out and just talking about white people like all white people are together. There's, I don't know how many countries that white people come from, and I guess they're all European. So I don't think there's anything wrong with people being proud of a specific country's heritage, but for somebody to just come out and be, yeah, I'm proud to be white. It's like, what is, like, what does that mean? I mean, proud of what? That your skin's a little lighter? Is there white culture? Now, somebody that's comes out and says they're proud to be Greek or Italian or from a country that has thousands of years of culture built up is a lot different than a person just obviously saying, oh, well, you know, that they're proud to be white or something. And that's, to me, that comes off as racist. But we're going to play this clip and talk about that. And I'm sure we'll have a lot to talk about with that. So, and then anything that you want to bring up. Today is the 304th show. And the reason I say that is because in the title I put to Don't Be a 304, there's a song, and people that are a little older may remember this, AMG, who also did the song Bitch Better Have My Money, which was sampled by Mark Wahlberg, and I don't know what song, but one of his songs. And he did the song Don't Be a 304 because back then, you know, when everybody had pagers, you would turn it upside down and it would say ho. So I had asked somebody that today who's older than me and wasn't really into the rap culture, so they weren't aware of that. But that's where that came from. So that's why I had put it in, those of you that had seen the title of today's show, which is, I actually called it no title for today or something like that, and it Don't Be a 304 because it's the 304th show. So we will talk about all that and more. First, I mean, the first thing I really want to do before, and I'm anxious to play this video, actually, because it kind of just caught me off guard. I was looking at on YouTube, and it was one of those videos that just popped up, like there were a bunch of videos there. And I happen to click on it, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on here? So it's definitely a video that I think will give people a lot to talk about, or at least me a lot to talk about, and hopefully people listening, a lot to talk about. If anybody's listening live, maybe they will call in, but the majority of shows, especially recently, have all been, the majority of listens have all been archive listens as opposed to live listens, which sucks, which makes the show a lot harder to do. I mean, to sit there and people don't realize it's not easy. People want to say it is. I've heard people try to say that before, that, oh, yeah, it's easy to sit there and do a 3-hour show. And it depends. You know, I've shortened the show to 2 hours, not because I can't come up with the 3 hours to talk, more because I need to get more sleep, which I didn't last night, unfortunately, staying up and writing. But I have been, in general, getting more sleep, so that's good. And I have a whole thing I do after I get off the air where I get ready for bed and I do things so in the morning I don't have to do them, like I'll shave. I'm sure everybody wants to know this. I'll shave, like, tonight so I don't have to shave in the morning. And I guess that's really it. That's all I do, like, to prepare for, you know, get my clothes out, stuff like that. And I'll also work out as well. But this video, it's... I don't know. And I'm not somebody to, you know, I've talked about how I grew up and that, especially in high school, that I hung around with, I had very few white friends, actually. I hung around with mostly black kids, and I sat at, there was like one in our lunchroom, like one table that was all black kids. And I was like the only non-black kid that sat there, for the most part. And there may have been like some Hispanic kids or something. And that didn't bother me or anything, but just to give people some background about me is... I even stood up to things back then. So I stood up to, you know, people that were racist, because living in the Boston area, there were a lot of people that were racist. Now, racism, the word racism is just thrown around. It's getting really ridiculous where people are being called racist that I would not consider racist, and the word just gets totally thrown around, and there's a difference between what I saw and what goes on now, just like there's a difference between what I saw and what went on before. I mean, I didn't see people hanged, and I didn't see stuff like that. I saw just people talking shit, and then we'd end up getting into fights or whatever. So it's a totally different atmosphere throughout the generations. But this, it's hard for me to sit here and believe, after what I kind of grew up with and what I witnessed, that things are all of a sudden worse now than what they were like 20 years ago. There's just no fucking way. There may be things that have been brought to light that were being ignored or people didn't know about, or, but to say that things are worse, it's just, to me, is just not the case. And as far as I'm concerned, you know, anybody can be racist. And I don't know, you know, with most, a lot of this stuff, when it comes to what I would call, not marches, but organizations that usually it's like, it's almost like the CIA being behind them. I mean, it's not literally the CIA, but it's that type of operation that the government, what they do, and maybe they use CIA operatives. I don't know. I don't think that they go and waste the training of CIA operatives to do stuff like that. I mean, I think they can get people at a lower level that work for the government to do this kind of stuff. But just like in places like Ferguson and Baltimore, where they get operatives from the government to go in there and cause trouble, rile people up, and do all these things, and also at the same time put out propaganda and try to get them on the news and get them the ones that are putting the opinions out there, as opposed to the real people that are out there, that are out there because they believe in what they're doing and they're trying to fight against the police. Like that, we talked about this before, the whole thing in Ferguson, where the majority of the people out there weren't about black and white. They were about fighting back against the police and then the media and government operatives and all of this bullshit, you know, forms Black Lives Matter and gets into all of that. And not to say that there aren't real people that are part of Black Lives Matter, but they're joining an organization that really was set up by the government to separate people, to divide people. Instead of people focusing all together on the police, it's divided people. So, and they do that on the other side too. And then you have stations like MSNBC and Fox News where they go back and forth and fight each other, and they do it on purpose. And it's just, it's ridiculous. So let me play this clip. And, you know, even shit like this, like, you don't know what to believe anymore. It's like you don't know what's real and what's not. Well, you may think that you do, but the reality of it is you may think that, but there's a lot of shit that is not real. And when I say it's not real, obviously it's real. You can watch a person that's going on about something. But what I mean is they could be an agent of the government. They could be somebody who's doing a false, you know, scripted video to rile people up, to separate people. Because the main thing that people fail to realize and are ignoring, actually, I really don't think they are. That's just what they're showing on the news and in the media and all that. But the main oppressors of black people and all races, actually, is the government. It's not the number one oppressors of black people is not white people. It's the government. Now, the government probably has a lot more white people than black people. So if you want to look at it that way, fine. But the government is, and the police are part of the government. The court system is part of the government. And they're oppressing everybody. I think they oppress black people more to an extent. But that's who's oppressing everybody. And if everybody got together and let the whole fucking looking at the race aspect of it go and said, look, we're standing up for people's rights. It doesn't matter whose rights they are. It doesn't matter that, you know, for this issue, it's mainly affecting black people, or this issue is mainly affecting Hispanic people or whatever. It's just everybody banding together and fighting for freedom, and any issue that violates the freedom of people, because I'm sure that the same issues, it might be on a larger scale, but the same issues are violating everybody's rights. It just might be, if you live in a poorer neighborhood, it might be on a higher level or a higher scale, as opposed to in a middle class neighborhood. But the same things are going on. And of course the government wants to divide people. And that's what the whole Michael Brown case was. And I did a whole show on that. That was about, you had all these cases. So you had that year, what was it, 2014, I believe. I can't remember if it was 2014 or last year, because so much stuff goes on. But I believe it was 2014, but it could have been last year. But either way, yeah, it was that it happened in 2014, but a lot of it ended up getting talked about in 2015. But instead of, you know, there were so many cases that had happened that there was no arguing. There was no way to argue the case. It was what it was. Unless you want to just, you know, pull out bullshit, but the majority of people would agree. So instead of taking a case that the majority of Americans would agree upon, that would all be shocked, including white people and all other races, instead of taking a case like that and showing it to everybody, the case that got focused on was a case that, I'm not saying that the police were right in that situation to shoot somebody that's unarmed is wrong, no matter how you want to look at it. And from what I had heard, you hear different stories. You know, I think that the cop was wrong, and I don't believe it was self-defense, or I believe possibly he thought maybe he was defending himself. I don't know. But my point being that is definitely a case that can be argued, where people can find things. If you're realistically looking at that case, you can find things and try to argue it and say, well, this person said this and this person said that, you know, and in both sides try to poke holes in it, as opposed to cases that were just on video where there's no argument. It's, this is what happened. And that's where I believe it was purposely done, to divide people, to have Fox News go back and forth with MSNBC and fight and bring this up and that up to keep it going and to divide people. And while you're fighting against other people, the government is just sitting there continuing to do what they're doing, taking more freedoms away, trying to federalize the police and do all of this shit. And that's what it was. And I'm not going to sit here because I feel like, well, somebody could call me racist or something like that, or which it, to me, that doesn't mean anything, because I know I'm confident in who I am and how I grew up and who I am as a person. So, you know, people that don't know me, you know, they can say whatever the fuck they want, whatever. But I'm not going to ignore things neither. and I'm going to look at them objectively. So if you have things like, you know, there were issues of the book, White Girl Bleed a Lot, where a whole bunch of black girls, not a whole bunch, but a group of black girls just beat up a bunch of white girls or whatever because they were white or something like that. That doesn't make it okay. And to blame people for things that have happened when they weren't even alive is ridiculous, or that they have nothing to do with. So at the same time, I can't look at things and say, well, this is okay, you know, and I'm not going to do that. But it's something that, again, the biggest threat, man, is not fucking your neighbor or, you know, your black neighbor or your white neighbor or your, you know, that's just it's just a whole move to distract people. It's like chess, man. You make a move to distract somebody while you already are 10 moves ahead on what you're going to do, and you already know what they're going to do. And that's really what it is. So anyway, and as far as white privilege goes, I mean, there's people that definitely have some kind of privilege. And there's black people that have privilege too. Okay? Let's not sit there and act like all, just because on the news you see like every black person lives in a poor neighborhood in the ghetto, that's not the reality, okay? It's not. Even if you want to say 20%, which is a big number, okay, that's fucking 80% that don't. So this whole thing that, you know, like every black person lives in a ghetto in a fucked up neighborhood where people are getting shot every night is not the fucking reality. It's not. You can look at the statistics of where, you know, from the census. And it may be that, okay, well, this section, you know, you take a city and say this city has like, I don't know, whatever, 9 really good sections to live. And you could say, oh, well, in this section, there's is 10% black, and this section is 20% black, and this section is 20% black. And if you add it up in those sections, you might have 80% black people. And then in the fucking ghetto section, you know, you have the other 20%, but they make up that whole section. Meaning the majority of black people don't live in the fucking ghetto. But then they're told, you know, there's this whole thing, the Hispanic community, the black community, and that's unfair to, you know, what does that mean? If you want to talk about a specific community, if you want to talk about, well, this neighborhood is black, and we're talking about this black neighborhood in Las Vegas or this Hispanic neighborhood in Las Vegas, then that's fine. Or even with Hispanic. I mean, do you know how many different fucking countries there are? I mean, the majority of black people in America have been in America over, you know, hundreds of years. You know, you have Jamaicans and Haitians and Africans and people from different countries, but the majority of black people in America, their families go back hundreds of years. And the same with white people, the majority, you know, and then you have foreigners from England and whatever, Germany and places like that. But Hispanic people, the only similarity between all Hispanic people really is that they all speak Spanish. But they're lumped into, like, you know, this is a Hispanic community because they all fucking speak Spanish. What the fuck is that shit? Anyway, I'm going to play this clip and we will be right back after this. Actually, I'm going to play both of these. Let me, we'll go from one to the other. So we'll be back after both of these clips. If you want to check us out, go to nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And of course, that Nonpartisan Liberty for All, you know, it's in the name. I'm all about freedom, true freedom, not the freedom that they're trying to sell people, the bullshit positive rights that you have the right to health care and you have the right to food and you have the right to a certain wage. Because nobody has that right. Nobody has the right to force someone to do something for you. But you do have the right to defend yourself. You do have the right to speak out and have free speech. You do have the right to do whatever drugs you want and put whatever you want in your body. I'm not saying that's a good idea, but I'm saying you do have that right. So there's, and you definitely have the right to do that without going to jail. So there's rights that people have, and I believe that all people have those rights, not just people that even are U.S. citizens. And that's it. What does that even mean anyway? It's meaningless. I believe all people in the fucking world have those rights. So check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and we'll be back right after this. Definitely pay attention to these clips because we're going to be talking a lot about them after. So again, we'll be right back after this. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and I am here every Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And again, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, and we'll be right back.
Hasn't even begun, and I already want to kill myself. Hey everyone, how's it going? Hunter Avalon here, and today we're going to be taking a look at this. Lazy white people. And this girl is basically mad about racism, yet she is completely racist herself. So, let's begin. It's very cringeworthy, but yeah.
No. Those out there with a melanin deficiency, it is not the job of black women to explain to you all in nauseam the ramifications of racism and white supremacy. We are not obligated to educate you on our oppression that we have to experience daily, that you benefit from on the daily.
All right, now hold on here. I understand this is a very sensitive issue, so I'm being kind of cautious with this. But at one point in American history, slavery was around and it was awful and it was horrible and to this day is still one of the worst things that happened in American history. And at that time, white people certainly did benefit off of the oppression of black people. However, it's important to remember that those white people that you call lazy also ended the slave trade and many lost their lives in order to free the slaves as well.
One of the things, and I'm not downplaying slavery because we're talking about in America, and that's definitely a difference compared to other places. You know, in America, that's probably the worst thing that has ever happened within this country. But when you talk about slavery, if you look through history and the amount of groups that were slaves under different regimes, and I know it goes back, you know, further and further, you know, when you're talking about, say, the, I don't know, because I forget all the, I'm not an expert in it and I forget the specifics, but the 9th century or the, you know, the 8th century or whatever, you know, going back a long time, you know, going back 5,000 years or something like that. But even more recently, though, there were indentured servants. There were, now I'm not comparing those because there are differences in there. There were agreements made, but at the same time, there were a lot of groups that suffered through slavery at some point within their heritage, within their, in their culture. And again, if we're looking at the United States, obviously it's a lot different, but I did want to add that. Now, that doesn't make anything that has happened okay or make it any better, because it doesn't. But at the same time, you can't just ignore that as well and tell stories that are not true. Because there's a number of not, I wouldn't say not true, but there's things that do get sensationalized or embellished or, but regardless, there is no way that you can in any way defend slavery or say that it was not a horrible thing. There's just no way you can do that. I mean, you could say that, but it's bullshit. So, and, but at the same time, and, you know, I know this sounds bad, of course, but, you know, there, for a long time, I think it was living the after effects of that. But at the same time, it has to get to a point where it's okay. You can't always go back to, well, you know, this happened, so, you know, this. Meaning that, you know, 500 years from now, is it still going to be the same thing, or 1,000 years from now? Because then you're getting into that same territory of, you know, the Jews were slaves, the Muslims were slaves, the, well, I don't know if the Muslims were slaves, the Irish were slaves. You know, you're getting into that same type of factual and similar history, and really it's just, this is the most recent and it's in this country. So I don't, and I'm not trying to come off badly with that, because it still makes a difference, because it did happen here. And I remember when I was in eighth grade and we went into detail with slavery and how horrible I thought it was. And I was disgusted by white people I really was. And my my heroes in eighth grade were the ones, I don't want to say the ones, the people, because I was going to say the ones, the slave rebellions, but the leaders of the slave rebellions, like Gabriel Prosser and, you know, John Brown was a white man who went and killed a bunch of slave owners, but he did it more because of religion. There were three major slave rebellions. Gabriel Prosser was one of them. I can't think of the other ones right now. Marcus Garvey keeps coming into my head, but I know Marcus Garvey was not a slave. That was later in, but their, Nat Turner was one of the other ones, and there was one more, and maybe his last name was Garvey, and that's why, but those were my heroes when I was in eighth grade. The people that went door to door killing slave owners. And I shouldn't fucking say that because it's like, you know. But that's how I felt. And I don't know that I feel any different now towards, you know, having that they did that, that there was anything wrong with them doing that. I mean, they were being held captive. They were being beaten and raped and all of these horrible things. So that was standing up and fighting back. But the thing that people forget is, who do you think? I'm going to break my headphones here. Who do you think made sure that they stayed where they did and that slavery kept going? The government. It's a fact. Somewhere, and I kind of blame like some of these Southern Republicans and whatever for throwing around the words freedom and liberty and things like that. But somewhere along the line, the Democratic Party, when they switched from being a total racist to trying not to be, and trying to still be racist, but doing it from a secretive way. Not that I support the Republicans neither, because they want to control you as well. But that they were able to convince people that it wasn't the government. And they have people voting now for candidates, not that it matters who you vote for anyway, but for candidates that support the government, that want more laws and more this and more that. So that to me is just crazy, because you turn around and who do you think the cops are? Who do you think they work for? The government. Who do you think trains them now? The federal government. Who do you think gives them tanks and automatic weapons? The federal fucking government. Why would you want anybody that wants more government? So we'll go back to this clip.
In this day and age, white people are not benefiting off of black people. And as far as I can see, our country is working very, very hard to end any form of racism whatsoever.
You are not entitled to our time. You are not entitled to our labor. You are not entitled to our kindness. You're not even entitled to a sliver of the sidewalk when we're walking outside.
Where are you getting this idea that everyone thinks they're entitled to something from you? No one said they're entitled to anything.
I just want to come and talk about how white people feel as if, you know, it's the job of black people, but black women in particular, to explain to them racism.
Wow, I'm learning so much about myself. You know, I didn't even know that I, as a white person, thought that way.
This is all sparked by a particular incident that happened on Tumblr.
Yeah, you're on Tumblr a lot, aren't you?
So anyway, I'm on Tumblr. I see that I got a message. So yeah, I go in there and I see, hello sir slash ma'am. Is white privilege a thing? If so, elaborate.
All right, well, it sounded like they asked a perfectly reasonable question, and if that's really all they said, it sounds like they were just trying to learn something new.
What you demanding information from? First off, I don't think you're in the right place, sweetheart.
The retard train has officially left the station. All right, no one was demanding information from you. They were asking a perfectly reasonable question. And now I see the reason behind you making this entire little pathetic video. One white person asked you a question that for some reason you didn't like, and that now means that all white people are lazy or expect black women to teach them something. Not only is that just 100% and completely wrong, it's such a screwed up way of looking at the entire situation.
If you don't know what white privilege is, this is kind of like racism one-on-one type sh-
Well, since she won't bother to explain white privilege, I'll go ahead and explain it. The definition says that white privilege is a set of advantages that white people benefit from on a daily basis because of their skin color. But truthfully, white privilege is nothing more than a way of the regressive left to attempt to silence people. Privilege is based far more on socioeconomics than anything else. According to US Census Bureau, 41.5% of white people live in poverty. That's nearly double the amount of black people. In 2014, 19.7 million white Americans were in poverty, more than any other group of people. Suicide rates are also much lower for minorities, according to census data. The suicide rate is currently rising for white Americans. White suicide has spiked over 40% in the last 10 years. So where's the privilege to help us out of suicide and save us from poverty? It's not there.
So if you don't even know what that is, like, you are very far behind. If you're a black woman, that's fine. I will teach you all day. This is what I do. This is what I'm passionate about. But if you are anyone outside of the realm of a black woman, if you're not in that group specifically, girl, like, go to Google.
Yeah, you did hear that correctly. She teaches people, guys. That's what she does. But she only teaches black people. That is plain and simple discrimination. And it's discrimination based on race, so it's plain and simple racism as well. Try to imagine for just 1 second that a white person said, "I only teach white people." The world would have a frickin' conniption. Besides that, you make yourself look weak, invalid, and like you just can't answer the question. How is anyone gonna take you seriously when you refuse to teach the people you claim need to be educated?
Google is free, bitch. She is open 24/7. She is always busting out all the knowledge. She does not discriminate.
Yeah, Google doesn't discriminate, but you do.
So yeah, he comes in there demanding information, and I politely direct him to my PayPal, and I cashioned it, no free intellectual labor or you pay me or something like that. Something along the lines of you paying me for the information that you expect me to give you.
Again, it doesn't sound like this person expected anything from you. They asked a question. If you don't want to answer it, don't answer it. But really, who the heck expects to get money for answering a question? That's literally the stupidest thing I've ever heard. You say right here on your Tumblr that you host a web series on sex and race relations. So it really only makes sense that someone may approach you asking some questions. Oh, but I forgot. They aren't black, so screw them.
You know how you pay for services, you pay for products? I mean, shit, you pay for education.
Listen, sweetheart, you aren't a teacher. You may like to believe you are, but honestly, you're just not smart. You're not educating anyone on your YouTube channel or on your Tumblr blogging about white tears. Even real qualified teachers usually give out some information if someone asks without directing them to their PayPal account.
So I don't even understand why you expect me, a stranger, to answer all of your questions just because you ask them. Oh, wait. I know why. You're white. Duh.
Yep, you totally got it. It's all because they're white that they took the time to consider you somewhat smart and ask a question. I mean, it probably had nothing to do with them maybe reading your bio and, oh, I don't know, maybe wanting to join the conversation. By the way, you should really include that white people have to pay a privilege tax first. Secondly, why are you even offended that someone asked you a question? I mean, I would understand if someone said, like, oh, she's black, she wouldn't know anything, but it's literally the complete opposite of that. Sure, you have every right to deny the question, but the fact that they asked you means that they consider you somewhat knowledgeable. That should be an honor, not an offense.
So yeah, basically when I screen capture that or whatever and I put it on Tumblr, girl, they just like ascended into my motherfucking mentions. I mean, just one after the other. Your cause is never going to get any attention if this is how you treat your allies. went all the way with that. Called that nigga ally and he don't even know what white privilege is.
And now you're getting mad when someone calls that guy an ally only because he didn't know what white privilege was. You laugh at him for not knowing, yet you refuse to tell him when he asks. I have an honest question for you. Do you want equality, or do you want to just be superior? One of the first steps in ending a system of oppression is for everyone to see each other as an equal and as an ally and work together to make the world a better place for everyone. I honestly don't think you really want that. You just want to screw white people and scream racial discrimination on your pathetic, sad YouTube channel. Helpful little hint? It's time to stop focusing on someone's skin color and start focusing on their true character. It's time to start focusing on who they are as a person. White people, black people, they're all just that. People, precious human lives that don't deserve to be treated poorly or stereotyped because of the color skin they were born with. You are not above white people. White people are not above you. We all deserve to be treated equally.
One, we don't need you guys. And if you feel as if we need you guys to get our point across, or if you feel that we need you guys if we have to abide by your rules and regulations on how we deliver that message, so basically you tone policing us, if you need all of that in order for you to believe that we're actually telling the truth, you ain't no ally.
Listen, you don't have to abide by anyone's rules, but when you make racist content, you're gonna receive backlash. And the people giving you backlash don't wanna be your ally, at least not anymore. All you do is discriminate against white people, even if they wanna join your cause. All you're doing is chasing potential allies away. You don't need white people, but why is it a problem to have them on your side? Why is it a problem to see past someone's skin color and look at who they are as a person?
I care about and I work towards uplifting, empowering, and mobilizing black women. That's it. So if you fall outside of those realms, I don't know what to tell you. Actually, I know what to tell you. Fuck you, pay me.
How do you ever plan on making any changes in the world? What do you honestly expect to gain by only talking to black girls and trying to make white people pay you money if they ask you a question? Do you really think that's empowering black women? Try this. Try going 1 week without being a complete and total racist and watch how many people may actually see your side.
Girls, black girls, my black beautiful black babies, charge these.
Okay, so don't act civilized and politely tell the people asking questions that you won't be answering questions right now. No, charge them and act insane! That makes you look really intelligent! Oh wait, no, it makes you look like a frickin' moron.
I do a lot of motherfucking work and it is very mentally and emotionally taxing to do all of this work just for people to come and say, one, you're being too sensitive, or teach me more.
Well, if people are asking you to teach them more, you probably aren't putting that much work into what you claim to be. But who cares? This video was a complete and total joke. Entitled Racist Girl, you've been wrecked. Hi, my name is John Smith, and as you can see, I'm white, privileged, and have a lot of white guilt, because I'm a total degenerate. If you're white like me, then you're privileged like me, and it's very important that you check your privilege every waking moment of your life. I hope you'll follow this short tutorial on how to check your white privilege. Step 1. You need to examine just how privileged you are. Your privilege depends fully on your skin color. It has absolutely nothing to do with socioeconomics. No, skin color is all that matters. To determine your true whiteness, look at your skin, but not your arm or your leg, because you could be slightly tanned in those areas. I suggest you go in the bathroom, strip down buck naked, and look at your bare butt, where you'll be the very whitest. Don't try and hide that pesky privilege under your fake spray tan, you little salt shaker. If you look like this, you have 100 out of 100 privilege points. Albinos like you are really better off getting killed and having your corpse thrown to the wild animals to ravish upon your privileged flesh. If you're mixed and you look like this, you still have some whiteness in you, so you have 50 out of 100 privilege points. You're not really better off dead, but maybe just very injured. And if your skin color is any darker than the examples we just showed, you have absolutely no privilege, and you deserve to be worshipped. Now that you've determined just how privileged you are, let's move on to step two. Step two, realize that you didn't earn anything. If you're white and have anything at all, it's not really yours. Your privilege got it all for you. Shopping at a store, the cashier actually gives you a discount just for being white. Is this TV yours? No, it's not. You didn't earn it. Heck, you probably didn't even earn this one. Is this car yours? Of course it is. It's white, and it's not really yours. Do you have a nice job? Well, you probably think you got it kinda like this?
Well, I went into debt to attend a really nice college and get a great degree. I have a lot of experience, I'm very qualified, I have a great resume, and I can start as soon as possible.
You're hired.
But you actually got it a lot more like this.
I'm white.
You're hired.
To get rid of this awful, unearned privilege, you can start by giving away your possessions to any person who is not white.
Hey, Jamal. Yeah, why don't you come over and I'll give you 500 bucks on my TV. I love getting rid of my white privilege.
Step three, realize you have advantages in life. Being white comes with all sorts of great advantages. Here are just a few of the best ones. Did you accidentally get a small cut? Well, your Band-Aid will match your skin tone. Science has even proven that since the Band-Aid is the same color as you, your wound will actually heal faster. Do you cry a lot because of all of your white guilt? Your tissue is the same color as you. Another advantage to cry about. Being white comes with another awesome advantage as well. You can break the law and never get in trouble with the police.
You were going 25 miles over the speed limit and you ran over three kids and a dog.
But officer, I'm white.
You're off the hook.
And finally, step four. Realize there's nothing you can do about it. You are so privileged that you're doomed to live a life of constant mockery because of your privilege. You are so privileged that you're doomed to have the point you're trying to make simply dismissed because you're a privileged white boy. You are so privileged that you're doomed to have people instantly label you as privileged because of your privilege. Sadly, you were born white, privileged, and cursed. And there's not much you can do to change it. The only thing you can do would be to tear off your own flesh, wallow in guilt, cry, and finally, just kill yourself. We hope you found this tutorial helpful and are now completely ashamed of who you are as a white person. Thank you for checking your privilege. I'm John Smith, dabbing out.
This video is sponsored by The Typical Liberal on Instagram. Be sure to click the link in my description and give their page a follow.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. So between those two videos, and I apologize that I'm not as prepared as I would have been, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show, I kind of didn't have a lot of time to prepare tonight, but I want to make sure that I am putting out a show when I say I'm going to put out a show and not just take the night off or play a replay or something like that. So the bottom line to me is that you have people within the government that are creating these groups, organizing these groups, and really even spying for the government at the same time. And instead of bringing people together, dividing people. So while people are fighting amongst each other, they can't unite and fight against the government, because that's who is really oppressing everybody. It's like when you look at corporations and people blame the corporations and they want to brainwash people that, oh, yeah, it's the corporations, it's the banks, and forget about the fact that the government is, you know, allowing these corporations to get away with all these things and passing all these laws to allow these corporations to dominate a specific industry and making the barriers to entry too hard for other companies to get involved. And the same with the banks being able to do whatever they want and being too big to fail, and the Fed printing all of this money and all of these things. So, you know, people aren't necessarily wrong in their conclusion as far as what's some of the things that are wrong or what the problems are, just in their cause of the problem, because it's bringing more government. And the same with the police. They were talking about federalizing the police after what happened in Ferguson. Why would you bring in more government when the government is the ones, or are the ones, that are responsible in the first place? So really my main point is that for me, I don't focus on any race or religion or any other difference that you can lump somebody into. It's about mainly one thing, and that's people's true freedom and liberty, and having that for all people, not just a certain race or a certain social class or any of that. It's about all people of all races, of all religions, of whatever, having those rights and those negative rights, not extra positive rights. And there's a difference. Negative rights would be, you know, the right, as I was saying earlier, the right to defend yourself, the right to freedom of speech, the rights in the Bill of Rights, as opposed to, well, I have the right to have health care. And if you look at that, really what you're saying is you have the right to force somebody to do something for you, because you have the right to force a doctor to perform whatever you need done. And you have a right to force people to pay for it. Now think about that. And that's the main, it's applied to other ideas as well. And that's their main, conceptually, that's what it is. And then they apply it to a bunch of different things. But nobody has the right to force anybody to do anything. Now, they do that because, of course, the government forces people to do things. But for me, I don't look at, well, this race is being, you know, attacked by this race, or in this incident, it's this race that's being, the rights are being violated. I just look at the fact of people's rights are being violated, and the negative rights. And that when people's rights are being violated, that's when something has to be done about it. And it's going to continue to happen as long as the government continues to get people fighting amongst each other, continues with this illusion of freedom and this illusion of, well, I have, you know, enough to get by and I don't want to risk that and all of these things, along with, you know, getting people to kill each other. But that's what the show is about, and that's what I'm about. It's not focusing on any race. It's making sure that, or fighting or talking about or getting the word out about people's rights being violated, not by race, and bringing that to the forefront, because it's about everybody. It's us versus them. Whether it's us versus the police or us versus the government or us versus any government agency. And that's what it is. So, in the interest of time, and of course, not preparing as much as I wish I had, I do want to do that sounds like a stupid sentence. I was going to say, I do want to do another show where I focus, where I'm obviously prepared and focus the show on what I think is really going on. And I have done shows in the past regarding that, like what happened in Ferguson and it being all about the perfect way to separate people, the perfect way to do it. And that's what I believe happened, you know. And it's unfortunate that he had died. But there's a video of, I bring this up occasionally, I had her brother on the show, Ernesto Duenas, I had his sister on the show, Reina Duenas. And there's a video of him getting shot and killed by the police. And he just gets out of the car and he just fires like his whole magazine right into him. No weapons or anything on him. And nothing happens to him. So, I mean, and he even said stuff to her later, like, oh, nothing's going to happen. You guys ain't going to be able to do anything. It's crazy. And it's only going to get worse. The amount of rights that you have, which are minimal as it is, are just going to continue to decrease. So, one of the other things that I had brought up at the beginning of the show were to kind of, I guess, lighten the mood a little, I guess, literally, are threesomes. And being that I have a clip that's kind of a good transition, let me play this. Let me make sure I have downloaded it first. And then let me play it, because it's actually T-Pain. And I know I had heard him on an interview on Howard Stern, how he is able to have threesomes with his wife. So, really, this kind of relates to the whole thing of, you know, feminism and how that is definitely something that it's crazy. And I look at it this way, to be honest, that they being the powers that be, the government, are trying to make any minority, although I don't know that women are a minority, but anybody who's, and when I say minority, I just mean that there's less of them in the country than they are not the majority, basically. So you have one of the other group, or not the other, but another group that they're trying to do this with is, of course, women, and make them feel like they're being taken advantage of. So you look at what the government's trying to do, and they're doing this on so many levels, I think, but is with every minority or group that they consider a minority, and women, I don't believe that at nationwide, I think there's more women than men, but to say that, well, women don't have as much power as men, so they're included in that whole, I guess, plan that they're coming up with. And what the progressives are doing are taking all these groups, or at least trying to, and trying to assume that they're ignorant, which they're not. I mean, every group has ignorant people, so those are the people that they get, but the majority are not. But that to get women, to get black people, to get Hispanics, to get any other minority group together and when you get them together, getting them to support the government and convincing them that they need the government to support them and help them to get out of whatever the issue might be. So, for example, you know, women not being paid enough, or racism with black people, or whatever it might be, to get them to look towards the government. And even though the government, especially when it comes to minorities, the government are the ones that are oppressing minorities, but to try to trick them into, okay, we're going to get basically every group except white males. And I don't know how I'd fit in there because, like I said, my father, his side of the family is Jewish. So, and no matter what, man, it's kind of fucked up. It seems that no matter how much time goes by, people hate the Jews. Even if you're like, I don't believe in the religion, but I guess it's a race as well. But anyway, to get people to rely on the government. So, like with women, you look at the increase in feminism and in the things that they're doing. So you would think from some of the reactions that, like, it's like the 1960s or worse, like it's the 1910s before women were even able to vote. that women are so abused in society. And of course, the idea that they're just sexual objects. So I'm going to play this interview. I didn't get to hear it because I just had seen it. But with T-Pain and his the threesomes he has with his wife.
You know how you say in the song, you go, she don't like girls, but a stack will make her kiss her? Like, yeah. How often does that happen?
Oh, a lot. It's usually, the other girl is usually my wife. So it's me, a stripper, and my wife. So that happens a lot, actually. Probably too much. We probably should slow down on that. Some of these bitches are nasty.
Well, you mentioned in your other interviews that you and your wife do threesomes.
Oh, yeah. That's fun, man. I don't know why people don't do that more often. That's weird. People should do that. Females should do that. Like, keep your man. Like, at least he's doing the shit in front of you. Like, you know what I'm saying? You want your man to just, like, I'm not saying that, you know, your coochie is born. I'm just saying if you get born to your man, maybe you want to spice things up. You know, that's not what a dude would want. Just like you don't want a girl in there, but something got to happen. You know, and dudes are usually the superior of the relationships and things like that. Just do something. At least kiss a bitch in front of him and then go home. Like, don't just leave the man. Don't go to the strip club with your man. Like, you don't want to be the cool bitch. Like, I always party with my man. I do everything with my man. We smoke weed. We do everything. Bitch, if you're going to do everything, then do what he wants too. Like, don't just, like, you can't just go out to eat and then go back home and just sit in the bed and be on Twitter all night. That's terrible. You better bring another bitch in there. Y'all can tweet what y'all doing in there. That's... You don't want that. You don't want to get born. But all these bitches are like, I ain't letting my nigga fuck another bitch. Blah, blah, blah. Baby, he doing it already anyways. He's already doing it. Just because you're not letting him do it don't mean he's not doing it. He's already doing it. You might as well have him do it with you. Let's make this a community effort. You don't want him to do it by himself. Stupid.
I mean, have things ever gone wrong in that kind of situation? Like, you just bring the wrong girl home and things just go left?
It didn't necessarily go left. Things did go wrong at one point, though. The bitch started liking me, for real. Like, the bitch, like, really, like, wanted to be my girlfriend. And she, like, started talking, like, let's go do this, and let's go out to dinner, and let's go. And my wife was like, wait a minute, bitch, that ain't what we're doing here. This is now, and then you leave, and then we keep living our life. And so, yeah, it went like that one time, and it went reverse. Like, the bitch wanted me to, like, leave. It was weird. I'm like, bitch, wait a minute. You gonna take this dick? You like it or not? It's gonna happen. There's a dick coming your way. That's the end of the story. You can keep that pussy in your face, but I will tell you, in about 12 seconds, there's a dick coming your way, and it looks good on you.
Now, who usually picks the girl? Is it usually you or your wife? Or is it just y'all just huddle together and decide on one?
It's usually a huddle. I'm like, baby, she's cute, right? Like, you know, she'll be like, yeah, she's kind of like, well, no, you said, yeah, in that kind of way. No, who else is cute? She's cute, right? Yeah, she is cute. That's the one. Bam. I'm going to go talk to her. You want to talk to her? I don't know. She looks like she got an attitude. I'll go talk to that bitch. Hey, look, bitch, come fuck us. Bam. Cut scene to the house. Bye. Right in the bed. There it is.
So, I mean, I guarantee you that feminist groups are not cool with shit like that, where, so they have a relationship, and I remember hearing this years ago on Howard Stern when T-Pain went on there and said, I think his wife was on with him, that they have a relationship where he doesn't go off and do anything without her. So at least, you know, at the time and in that interview, that it's totally about her and when he does something, you know, they do it together, that they have threesomes together. And, you know, you think about the fact that he's famous and he can go out and get all these girls. I mean, it's probably for her a good way for her to keep her husband, because he might end up going out and, you know, getting with other girls. It was funny. I think it was in Bring the Pain when Chris Rock said, you know, a man's only as faithful as his options. And I'm not saying that I believe that personally for myself, but it does seem like a lot of men, it depends on, you know, you look at famous actors that can get any girls they want. And how long do those marriages last? You know, usually they don't last that long unless they have some kind of rule like, okay, you know, I can do whatever I want when I'm out here or when I'm on a movie set or whatever. I don't know. I don't know how you get by that way. I think what he does, and the fact that his girlfriend, I mean, his wife likes girls, and she allows him to be with them while she's there, you know, seems like a way to keep him happy and keep him there and keep their relationship together. Because that, based on, you know, I was going to say the type of guy that he is, but the type of guy that a lot of guys are. So, but I guarantee you that you have that conversation with a feminist and they're like, what the fuck? And that's fucked up. And well, but maybe you have that conversation with just a normal girl and they think it's fucked up too. And I'm not talking about asking a normal girl to do that. I'm talking about just having the conversation about the fact that he does that, not that that they want them or their wives or girlfriends to do that. But feminism has just, it seems like, gone out of fucking control, man. It's, again, you would think with, when it comes to racism and feminism and all of these things, that it's like we're living, you know, 50, 60 years ago. And yeah, anybody who says that racism does not exist is full of shit, and they know it. Of course it does. On the same side, though, and I guess it depends how you define racism, because people want to say that they only define racism based on power and things along those lines. But whatever you want to call it, whether you want to call it discrimination or racism, there are a lot of things that happen on the other side, meaning, you know, as I mentioned, I read that book, White Girl Bleed, a lot, and there's plenty of instances of black people beating up white kids just because they're white. And, you know, that happens a lot of times as well. So it's not one-sided. It's not like, you know, it was maybe 50 years ago, but unfortunately, you know, it would have been nice to see back then people grab arms and, you know, fight back. And I'm sure it was a lot harder when you have the whole, you know, local government on the side of the people that are attacking you. So, but when it comes down to it, there are plenty of instances of black people beating up white kids as well, and black girls beating up white girls also. And it's documented. A lot of it, people film it and put it on YouTube. And sometimes the people that are filming it are the people that are doing it, which is really fucking stupid, because then you get caught for it. I don't know why somebody would do that. That's just ignorant. But anyway, so I don't know what the percentage of this is or how often it happens, but that does happen as well. And to me, again, I don't get involved in, you know, I don't believe in hate crimes as far as it allows the federal government to get involved. If somebody beats somebody up, then they should be charged for beating them up. You can get enough punishment from assault and battery than having to add an extra charge of a hate crime on top of it. So I know why they did it initially, because what was happening was in the states and the South, like what happened in Mississippi burning, they'd find them not guilty, and then there was nothing that the federal government could do. So I know that's why they did it initially. But then later, meaning now, I don't think that those laws should exist, period. I think, you know, assault and battery is assault and battery. And if you beat somebody up badly, trust me, you'll get enough punishment or time in jail or whatever that is substantial enough, instead of having to also bring a case of a hate crime as well and bringing the FBI into it. And again, I know why that started, and the motivation behind it was a good reason, but having the federal government involved in it at this point is not a positive thing, in my opinion. But anyway, back to threesomes. So besides, I'm just trying to tie it into the whole, I guess, theme of what we're talking about. But while we're doing that, we can also just get into the point of threesomes. So I want to play this clip real quick, that threesomes are a bad idea, 10 reasons why, and then talk about those reasons, because there's things like destroying your relationship and questioning things later. And so let's play that real quick, and we'll be right back. NonPartisanLibertyForAll.com. If I can find it. Here it is.
Can I just get one thing straight about the topic this week? I didn't think of it. I've really tried to make this video not too smutty or crude or everything else everyone thinks about me. I mean, I don't even know why I'm bothering talking. Let's just start. One. Even bringing up the subject of a threesome is dangerous. I mean, it could be an amazing experience if you approach it in the right way.
When we're out tonight, shall we sort of find someone to join us?
I reckon we should fucking do it.
Oh, amazing.
Love how open we can be with each other.
It's just exactly what I wanted to do.
It's going to be so fun. Or if you approach it in the wrong way, well, it can be the end of your relationship.
Look at that one.
That's amazing.
Oh, man. Kieran is such a good laugh, isn't he?
Oh, he's fucking hot.
Yeah, so you can, right away... So, and I'm essentially trying to take the perspective of, okay, you're a guy and you want to have a threesome with you and your wife or your girlfriend. And just for the to give a little background, I've never had a threesome with two girls, although I would like to, but not with my fiance, and I probably never will, because when it comes to somebody that I care about, I would get jealous. I wouldn't want to see her with anybody else, including a girl. So I would never do that. Now, if it was two girls I didn't care about, I wish it's something I did when I was younger, when I didn't have a girlfriend that I was able to. And when I say that, I wish it was something I did when I was younger. It's not like I had girls knocking down my door asking me to have threesomes with them, neither. But, you know, bringing it up alone can be a little dangerous, because the girl might think, what, you're not getting enough from me. You need to be with another girl, or you need to see me with another girl. Or so there's a lot of things that go into from asking all the way to actually going through with it. So, well, what I'm going to do is I'll just play this whole clip through, and then we'll talk about it after.
Oh, I've always wanted to have sex with him.
What?
Two? If you do decide to do it, who do you choose? Is it someone you know really well, like your best friend, but then it could make it really weird between you? Or is it a complete random that you've never met before who you chose on the internet?
It's open, come in!
Oh my god, I'm so excited. Ready? I'm Emily. Ready? Three. The awkward instigation. Let's say you found the third person. The three of you are there. How do you get that started? Four? Room in the bed. For those of us that are normal, we just have a standard double bed size. Does that make sense? So how is there enough room for three of you in one bed?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, shit, you okay, Emily?
Yeah, fine. Just go on without me. It's fine.
Five. Communication. When it's just the two of you, you can get away with communicating with your actions. But when there's three, it's going to take some coordination, and you might need to use actual words.
Right, you get over there, and you stay there, because I'm gonna ride you like a lawnmower. I'm sorry, I'm not good. I'm really not good at this.
Six. No one likes competing for affection, especially in an intimate setting. So what do you do if two of you just seem more compatible than the other person?
Okay, guys, I'm back. Oh, yeah. Let's get this.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay, you two look like you're fine at the moment without me, so I guess I'll go make a cup of tea then, yeah?
Yeah.
That's it, yeah.
Seven, the comparison. Let's say it's me, another girl, and a guy. I'm not going to want her to be skinnier than me or have bigger boobs than me, which isn't difficult. But yeah, I don't want someone better than me.
Nyx, you look amazing. Okay, Ems, we're ready for you. Come in.
Are you fucking shitting me? Eight. Now this one's for the guys, and Ali actually came up with this reason. But I, as a girl, can verify this. Women can be complex creatures in bed. You don't always know what you're doing. Down there.
Oh, you fucking like it, don't you?
Ali, we're over here.
What?
Nine. Bumping into the third person out and about. I mean, sure, in the heat of the moment, everything's great and you're all getting along swimmingly. But when you're doing normal everyday things, like shopping, shit's gonna get weird.
Hey, oh, hi, how are you?
Hi. Yeah, I'm really good.
I'm really sorry we haven't called you.
Yeah, I've been meaning to call you. Have you been? You've been good?
I'm good, I've just done some shopping, bought some bread.
Man, wow, I love French bread. I haven't had any since we used it to... Anyway, it's been good seeing you. We should go. Let's...
Right. Yeah. Bye.
And 10. What if you absolutely love having threesomes? I mean, having sex with just one person won't be sufficient anymore.
Sorry, what's this?
One, do you even do your hair? No offence. could that comment be more appropriate for today? 2, I want to eat you out and come on your toes. Dad? 3, you're a cutie, but sometimes you go overboard. I'll take that. Now, before I go and put me and my amazing hair today to bed, I do want to thank 2 very great people for helping me with this week's video. The girl was called Nick Selena. She has a really amazing blog called Sex in London City. I'll put the description in the link below. And the guy, as some of us know, is Alistair Cohen, who technically, I think, should have paid me to be in this week's show. Right, it's time for me to go and get myself a Jaeger bomb. I'm joking. Just so everyone knows, I don't feel comfortable doing this at all.
Come on. I just want to tell my mum. This is all fine.
We're both Jewish. Don't worry,
it's all
Mrs.
fine.
Cohen.
Yeah, it's all okay. This has all been sanctioned by the rabbi.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how uncomfortable do you feel?
I'm having a great time. I'm just happy to be at the house.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. If you have any thoughts on threesomes, if you have any experience and want to talk about it, and not talk about the actual act, but how you got your wife or girlfriend to actually do it or anything like that, you can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And you can Skype in at Nonpartisan Liberty for All, where the sound is a lot better, and just send a contact request along with your name and what you want to talk about. Now, there's somebody on my I'm looking at my Skype list that I I know she's had threesomes, and you've had her on the show before, and it would be good to ask her. But anyway, so there are a whole bunch of things that come up when you ask somebody to have a threesome, because, and of course, the amount of time you've been together matters. And depending on who it is, it may matter in a positive or a negative way. I mean, it may be, you know, okay, if you've been together for a long time, you would think that that would be better if you'd been together for a long time rather than been together for a shorter time. But on the other side of that, at the beginning, maybe that's something you can do once and get out the way or something like that, as opposed to wanting to do it later. Like if you end up in a serious relationship with that person and having kids and getting married, and then at that point, is probably not the time to ask them to have a threesome. So I don't know what the, and I don't even know how they would get them. It'd be interesting to have some statistics on how many people have had, how many couples have had threesomes. And I'm talking threesomes like a guy and 2 girls, not a guy or 2 guys and a girl, or I guess that would be the only other one if there's only 3 people, or a guy, a girl, and a horse, or something like that. That would be really weird. I would get jealous enough. See, I don't see the point for that. I don't understand any of that shit. I had a friend, or actually was a roommate for a while as well, and nobody's going to know who this is, so it doesn't matter that I'm not going to mention his name or anything, but that I mention it. But he let his friend have sex with his wife, and he would sit there and watch and, like, jerk off. And then he wanted me to have sex with some girl that he was seeing so he could just, like, watch. And I'm like, that's weird to me. I don't know. And his logic was, well, haven't you ever watched a porno? I'm like, well, yeah. Well, it's like a live porno. I didn't end up doing it. It was, I almost did because she, you know, kept touching me and it was kind of hard not to, it was kind of hard. It was kind of difficult to resist not doing anything. So we messed around a little and then I got to the point where it's just like, okay, I'm not going to do this with you in the room. That's just too weird to me. It's just not my thing. And I don't judge people or anything. I mean, whatever you want to do, you know, that's totally up to you. I don't have a problem with that really, but the the whole idea of having any type of guy involved is, I don't get that. And there's some people that like it. I guess he liked to watch his girlfriends and his wife get fucked by other people. And I don't know. I'd hit the person. Like, that's how I am. I mean, I don't want anybody touching my girlfriend at all. So it's hard for me to relate to that. I mean, it doesn't matter how long I've been with them. I wouldn't want anybody touching them. And that's where it even comes into play with another girl, because even there, it's still the same thing. To an extent, you know, it's not a guy, but it's still a girl, and it's still hard to do that without getting jealous, because I probably would get jealous, you know, even though it's a girl. I mean, you think about things like this, too, and you could say it's insecurity, but you think, like, well, what if, and there's been movies about this. There was a movie called The Sex Monster, which was pretty funny, with Mike Binder and I forget her name, but she's from, like, an acting family. I can't think of her name. It wasn't one of the Arquettes, I don't think. But anyway, or maybe it was. It might have been one of the Arquettes, actually. But anyway, so the I heard a noise, so I totally lost my train of thought. I think it's like the cat trying to get in. So he, in this movie, right, she doesn't want to do it. At first, she's like, no, I don't want to do it. It's not something I'm interested in. I don't want to be with a girl. And she had never done it before. And then he's, you know, trying to talk her into it, of course. So he goes through all these reasons why they should do it and they should expand their horizons and this and that and whatever. So I'm like, okay. And then what happens is she does it finally after a while with a girl I think she works with. I don't remember if she works with her or not. And she not only likes it, but she likes it so much that she starts fucking any girl that she meets, she wants to have sex with. So she has sex with like his boss's wife and his friend, his co-worker's wife, and all these people's wives, and everybody's mad at him because she's having sex with the wives, and then everybody is he is trying to stop her from, you know, going after all these girls because she's starting to go after girls that it could get him in trouble, like the boss, not his boss, but a guy he's trying to make a deal with. In the end, she tries to get with her. And it's actually more the guy's wife that he's trying to make a deal with more than her. Because by that point, she's starting to, you know, stop it. But she ends up going over there, and he finds out, and they get in a fight, and it's kind of a funny movie. I don't know. It's a fun movie. It's not a movie that I'd say, you know, this is a great movie, you got to see it. But it's a, I think I have it on DVR still. It's a fun movie to watch, you know. And but the main point in the movie was that she didn't want to do it, and then she becomes like this crazy lesbian. And it's like, what if you have your girlfriend, you know, agrees to do it once, and then she likes it so much that, you know, she becomes like bi, and then maybe she gets to a point where she doesn't like penis at all anymore, and she says bi totally. And I'm sure a feminist would love that because they, okay, I'm stereotyping. I was going to say that feminists hate men, but they lesbian feminists, and this is, see, I hate doing this because I'm making a generalization and I'm kind of stereotyping, but usually lesbian feminists, not lesbians in general, because I know lesbians and I'm friends with lesbians, and they're actually, I know a lot of lesbians from one lesbian, and they're nice people just like everybody else and normal people. But usually the lesbians that hate men, or the lesbians, the feminists that are lesbians, and I'm making a general statement, and I know I'll probably get shit for it, and I don't want to lose any lesbian listeners because I love my lesbians as well as any other group. As long as you believe in freedom, that's all that matters to me, to be honest. And I would think if you're listening to the show and you're a fan of mine, then you can't be a man hater, unless you're just listening to the show and you hate the show, but you listen to it, like I do that too. But in general, and again, I'm just making a general statement that lesbians that are feminists hate men or might not like men that much. Because I don't think they... And the reason I think that, besides the fact that, you know, all the things I've read, but that they don't really have any use for them. You know, because they're not dating them. I don't know that they'd want to be friends with them, because why bother, I guess? You know, like, why? Bother being friends with a guy when you're a lesbian feminist? Why not just kind of cut them out of your life? Now, depending on where you work, unless you work at a lesbian newspaper or something, you know, you may not be able to do that. And, you know, what's kind of weird is that, not weird, but it's uncommon that when it comes to gay guys, and again, this is a stereotype, but it's true that a lot of the feminine gay guys, and I have nothing against gay guys. I'm friends with gay guys and whatever. Like I said, my main thing is, as long as you believe in freedom and liberty and are against what the government is doing, you're okay with me. But that more, you know, feminine guys like to hang out with girls. But I don't know, or I've never heard of manly lesbians wanting to hang out with guys. And I don't know if anybody else has neither, but I've never really heard anything about that, about lesbian... manly lesbians wanting to hang out with guys. You know, as opposed to there's a lot of gay guys that are just manly gay guys that I'm sure have regular, that don't hang out with, you know, a lot of girls, that they hang out with guys. But the feminine gay guys, a lot of them hang out with girls. I mean, it's not, that's not even really a stereotype. I mean, it's kind of, I would say that's more of a, of, I don't want to say it's a fact, but most feminine gay guys would tell you that, yeah, I have a lot of friends that are girls that I hang out with, which is fine. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. And I even know, you know, my fiance has a lot of gay friends that she hangs out with, and they hang out with a bunch of girls, and that's fine. But it doesn't seem to work the same way with lesbians. And I don't know why that's the case. But it is an interesting thought, though. I guess I'm trying to think from a logical standpoint. I mean, I guess the gay guys that are feminine, you know, they have more in common with women, they feel, than men. So, or men might make fun of them, or, you know, so it makes sense that they would want to hang out with women. But the manly lesbians, it would make sense, I guess, that they'd want to hang out with men, but they don't. I mean, I don't know. Maybe they just want to hang out. I mean, personally, I'd rather hang out in general, especially if I don't have a girlfriend. I'd rather hang out with women, preferably single, cute ones. But yeah, I mean, I'm different. I really don't hang out with a lot of people in general. So, you know, I just hang out with my fiance and, you know, a couple people that I'm friends with. And if I was single, I would just be, you know, trying to go out on dates or something, or, you know, for a while, probably being a hermit until I was ready to, you know, do that. But anyway, that's just an interesting thing, that why, you know, and where the hate comes from. And maybe it's from the father. I would think that a lot of manly lesbians probably had issues with their fathers. I don't know. That's just speculation. I have no fucking idea. Total speculation, but it's possible. So anyway, we don't have a lot of time left. I wanted to talk about the Libertarian Party and what I had heard today on Free Talk Live, and talk about Darryl W. Perry and his experience there. I guess I think he came in fourth place from what I understood, which is pretty good for somebody who, I think he ran for like office a long time ago locally when he was in, what was it, Alabama or something, for something small. But I mean, to run for the Libertarian candidate or nomination for president, and if he did in fact come in fourth, I mean, that's pretty good. He was the only one to actually stand up for his principles. And he had mentioned that they said it on the stage, and I had missed this because I listened to some of the debate. I watched it on YouTube, or listened to it on YouTube, but I didn't listen to the whole thing. I'll have to go back and listen to to what I missed. But the ultimate winner, Gary Johnson, I guess from what I understand, he said they were asking each other questions, and Gary asked Darryl to be a consultant on how to be more libertarian, which sounds kind of scary if you think about it. And I can't fucking believe this. So the vice presidential nominee, because I'm originally from Massachusetts and I've been in Las Vegas 15 and a half years now, but who used to be the governor of Massachusetts? The Republican governor of Massachusetts. Well, a guy named William Weld. William Weld, they said, is the fucking nominee for vice president for the Libertarian Party. And this is a guy who was the one who I had fucking gotten arrested when he was governor. And he put mandatory sentencing on for certain items, and he almost fucked me. But, you know, again, that's behind me. And, yeah. So it was just fucked up, the fact that he was there as well. And that he, not that he was there, but that he ended up with the nomination. And he was always a straight up Republican. I mean, he wanted the mandatory sentencing for drugs and stuff like that. And this guy's not a fucking libertarian. And Gary Johnson isn't much of a libertarian neither. And he's the one who had said that to Daryl. And really, Daryl was the only one who actually came out and stood up for his principles. And nobody else, maybe it's because they don't have libertarian principles, but for the most part, I mean, there were a couple guys here and there. It's hard to keep track of them all, because what you would have is you'd have one debate, and Daryl was at most of them, but you'd have one debate that had, you know, a certain amount of people, but was missing a couple guys. And then you'd have another debate that was missing other guys that weren't missing from this debate, but now there's new guys in this debate. And it was, you know, a whole big thing. So you had, it was kind of scattered, where, say, one of the candidates, I don't know how many debates there were. Let's say there are 50 debates and there was one in every state, and I don't know that there was, but let's just say there was, you know, you'd have people that maybe attended 20 debates or something, you know, and didn't attend all of them. I don't know how many Daryl attended, but I saw him at a lot of the debates. So, yeah, it was pretty good for somebody that, you know, didn't have a lot of money to invest in the campaign. And I know he got a lot of donations, so that's probably why he was able to do it. But again, I mean, he was the only one, and this was his goal anyway, because this is what he said when he was on the show, that he just wanted to, kind of like what Ron Paul did, he just wanted to get his message out there. And hopefully he did it. So we'll see what happens. But the Libertarian Party is not really libertarians. They're like Republicans that think drugs should be legal. And I don't even know that all of them even think that. I mean, they're... And that's not the best way to describe them, but they're more of Republicans, ultimately, a lot of them, or conservatives, than libertarians. And that, of course, is sad. And I remember hearing that a lot of people were doing this. And it might even have been Chris Cantwell who had brought this up a long time ago, that people would move over to the Libertarian Party because they could be, you know, in a year, they could be like director of the party. I mean, because it was small. So they could come from the Republican Party and move over there and kind of take it over. So, one, I don't believe in political parties anyway, even the Libertarian Party, even based on their platform or if their platform met what I believe in. And I don't know how you can have a Libertarian Party that doesn't want to tear down the government, because from what I understood, the libertarians don't want a government, because how can you, if you believe in the non-aggression principle, you can't have a government, because government's based on force. So how can you have a government if you believe in the non-aggression principle? Now, what the Libertarian Party could do if they wanted to really try to just get in there and try to sneak some things past the establishment, which I don't think that would happen, because once they got to a certain size, they'd probably have people watching them. But, you know, really, all they'd have to do is come out and say that. I mean, a couple of them came out and said that they believe in the non-aggression principle. I believe Austin Peterson said that, but he still believes in government. You can tell by the answers to all of the majority of his questions. So explain to me how you can believe in the non-aggression principle but still believe in government. Because I'm trying to think about that right now. Because if government is based on force and violence, which it is, right? So how do you do that? And to me, the answer is you can't. Plus, I always thought that's what libertarian meant anyway. And then somewhere along the line, it got totally corrupted. It got turned into this party that somehow wanted to be commercially accepted instead of standing up for its real principles. And they wanted to compromise the actual principles of the Libertarian Party, which I believe that's what they're doing. And it makes it pointless to be part of this party anyway. You know, really, if you're a limited government person, if you're somebody who wants limited government, really, I don't know that there is a party for you, but fucking start, you know, the limited government party. I mean, or the constitutional. I think there's a constitutional party, because that really would be, I think somebody who believed in limited government would fit into like a constitutional party or something like that. But anyway, I guess Daryl ended up, he said, well, ask me on Sunday, because I guess Sunday was, you know, the final, you know, everything would be decided by then. And I guess one of his staff members asked, and of course, Daryl, you know, said no. And as, you know, I would as well. I mean, why is he gonna, you know, what's the point of doing that? It's pretty pointless, I think. And, you know, Gary Johnson, I have nothing against him. That seems like a nice guy. He doesn't have the, you know, to be, at least in my opinion, if you're going to be part of a third party, and he was governor of New Mexico, which is impressive for a libertarian nominee. Now, he was a nominee in 2012 as well, which I think he should have stepped aside instead of running again. But OK, he didn't. And hopefully he doesn't run again. If he does and they vote for him again, that's just fucked up. But what, you know, they need, I think, is one is somebody who, you know, I thought McAfee's kind of personality might have fit it, but I think he was, instead of being himself, he was being too calm. I think they need somebody to come out there, you know, and have a not crazy personality, but, you know, not be too laid back, to be more like Bernie Sanders or something when he's yelling about something. Somebody more like that than somebody like, you know, Gary Johnson, who's just kind of, you know, yeah, he has a personality, but he's just too laid back. Plus, he ran before anyway. And, you know, who knows how well he's going to do, and does it even matter at this point, really? You know, they have their thing. They go through their party, literally. And, you know, hopefully everything goes well, but I don't see anything changing. And again, you can't change the system through the system, period. Maybe you could have done that 100 years ago. You can't do that now. It's not going to happen. It's too big. It's too powerful, meaning the system, for that to be an option or something that is going to get the people on your side. So, I wish him luck. I hope he gets us a good percentage of votes. And hopefully he will, but, you know, it's really like, what's the fucking point? And before I go, because I got to end this here at 9:30, which I should have probably ended it at 9, but the I totally forgot what I was gonna say, because I went see, I hate when I do this. So I went and looked on Facebook, right? And then looked at a message and then totally lost my train of thought. And then, is that live now? Oh, somebody's broadcasting live from Facebook that I know. I don't know her that well, but, and she's actually a lesbian. So we were talking about lesbians. So that's kind of funny. I should have asked them some questions. Anyway, so I totally lost my train of thought then, because I was going to say in the last couple minutes or the last 10 minutes that we have left, so I can end at 9:30. I wanted to, and I'm getting really tired, I really wanted to talk about, you know, the parties and how it's all pointless and it's already decided. But the other point that I'm kind of trying to remember was, you know, the that it's all pointless, that nothing is going to change from these political parties and from the voting and from the system itself. The main thing, the first thing, is knowledge. Because if people don't have the knowledge and they don't have the truth and they don't buy into the truth and they don't know what's really going on, then you don't have people supporting you. So that's really number one, I think, in my opinion, is you need a certain amount of people to support you, to believe in you, and to know that not only just to know the truth about the government, but at the same time to be able to trust you that you're giving them the truth and you're giving them what you know and what you really believe, that it's not bullshit, that it is what it is. And then from, you know, like what we like to call, you know, hearts and minds, again, being one of the most important things. And the reason I think it's so important, too, is because that's what will hold people from taking over. And, you know, like people that say, and I'm a person that would say this as well, I don't believe in violent revolution for a lot of reasons. And one of the reasons, of course, is that the same fucking thing is just going to happen again. But the more hearts and minds you have, the more people that believe in you, or, I mean, it doesn't have to be you like me, but whoever is or whoever the people are that are communicating the information to people. And then from there, that's where if you can build a certain amount of people, a following that is down and believes in the truth. And I keep saying believes in the truth because that's what it is. It's the truth that the government extorts money. It's the truth that there's no consent. All of these things are true. And that's just a couple. You know, there's so many to name. So what I'm saying is that when one of the this is where I got totally off track, sorry. The as far as a violent revolution, that if you have the hearts and minds, and when I say you, I don't mean even one specific person, I mean collectively as a whole, that all the hearts and minds of the majority are basically in the same place. They pretty much believe the same thing. That's the end of the as far as worrying about people taking over or another revolution or something like that, that's what will stop that. That's insurance on the bad people basically trying to take over, is what it is. And that's why I thought that was so important, because when you have the hearts and minds, it means so much more than when you rule by the barrel of a gun, because that's the alternative. And of course, in this scenario, there really wouldn't be rule per se anyway. There would just be an organized society. But the difference is the people that rule at the barrel of a gun compared to people that just live and do it based on, you know, what they believe in. And that's why you could never maintain, if you don't have the hearts and minds, you could never maintain a society without a government, because some bunch of idiots are going to try to take it over. Now, if they know that there's two things. One, if they know that they can't, because there's just too many people who believe in what you're trying to do or what you've done as far as establishing a society without a government that's just an organized society, that's governmentless, or they try it anyway and there's enough people to fight back. So, to me, it's the hearts and minds, the education, the truth of what's going on. And that's what makes it so easy, really, because you're just giving people the truth. It makes it easy from that standpoint. It's not easy to be able to do it in a way that people will want to listen to you, that you'll be able to convince people, that you'll be entertaining while you do it, and all of those things, because they might just listen and be like, this sucks, and just turn it off. Like, especially if I sounded the way I sound now, like every day, like, because I'm starting to fall asleep. But and it's not just me, of course. There's a lot of other people as well. But I'm just, you know, for the purposes of what I'm saying now, I'm talking about me. But from there, that's where, if you're able to build that group of people that believed, that's where you get to the non-compliance. And then that's where you get to the self-defense if you have to. Hopefully you don't, but I'm sure you do. And then from there, you just don't know. You don't know what you try to anticipate. And surely they have artificial intelligence. They have all these things like that. And that's really all you can do. And to me, that's the only way to save some form of freedom. The non-compliance, especially. Because without that, it's over, if it's not over already. Because you're not going to change the system through the system. So that's done. That's just not going to happen. And I don't believe, you know, people can tell me whatever they want. It's just not going to happen. There's no way, based on the technology, the current setup, the people that really run things, it's not going to happen. Even on a local level, I mean, it'd be hard to do. So what I do see on a local level is that's where the non-compliance starts. That's where you don't comply with the local laws. And I'm not talking about just for the sake of not complying with them. I'm talking about things that they have no right or justification in implementing and going after you for. And it's when they go after you for them that you stand up. And then, you know, maybe it's just a situation where you slow things down, where whatever plans they had, you put them on a, you know, instead of something that they would have accomplished in 10 years, it takes them 15 years or 20 years or whatever. Or, you know, maybe you're not able to do anything. So that's all the time we got for tonight. I apologize for being so tired and unprepared tonight. Because I was so tired, I really didn't get the chance to prepare like I wanted to. But we'll be back tomorrow, and I will be more prepared. Hopefully I will get to sleep pretty soon, I'm hoping, and I will have a more alert show tomorrow, and hopefully a more entertaining show. But I just want to leave you with the reality of this. And in what I say, this is no joke, man. This is straight up how it is. And, you know, there's not a lot of options left to have freedom in the future. So, thanks everybody. I appreciate, of course, anybody that listens. And if you'd like to donate, you can go to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And there's, of course, a place to donate. If you can or don't, it's not a big deal. You can also go and start to read the series on the legalization of drugs and why drugs should be legal like they were in 1914, because the freedoms that are being taken away because of the drug war, I don't think people realize how many freedoms are being taken away and what the government is doing. So thanks, everybody. Have a good night, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.